In this session, let's start looking at the capital structure, which is nothing but it's a mix of the debt and equity of raising capital, modes of raising capital for a company, and how should I choose this mix such that the value of the company is maximized. Right, so this is the prime intention of this session. We have to choose that level of capital structure, debt and equity mix, or sometimes people call it as that level of leverage, because leverage as such is nothing but the proportion of debt in the total capital that is raised by the company. So what is that proportion of debt, or what is that proportion of leverage the company needs to take in order to maximize the value? Because at the end of the day, the main objective of any company is the maximizing the value to the shareholders. So with that as a base, let's try to understand some of the theories that are involved with the capital structure. The most prominent of them are being proposed by Modigliani and Miller, typically called as the M&M propositions. So they have made some kind of statements about the capital structures of the company. So we'll start off with that and slowly move towards the analysis of how I can use the different theories to determine what is the optimal capital structure for the company, and at the same time, how can an analyst evaluate the capital structures of the different companies in the local market as well as across the companies internationally also. So let's get started. So initially, when we are talking about the various theories regarding the capital structure, we have Modigliani and Miller propositions 1 and 2. There is a no tax version versus a tax version for both of them. So the Modigliani and Miller's theories or propositions, there is a no tax version versus a tax version. Some of the important things is when there are no taxes, and even the transaction costs, and even the bankruptcy costs. That is a case of a perfect markets. So whenever a company is operating in a perfect market environment, which in reality is a very big difficulty, but whenever we are talking about a company working in a perfect market environment, this perfect market should not be confused with perfect competition markets in economics. But here we are talking about no transaction costs, no taxes, no bankruptcy costs, nothing. In that case, the capital structure is really irrelevant. So what does that mean? Probably if we look at it, revenues minus expenses minus depreciation, whatever you get as EBIT, and from there you subtract the I, and from there you get EBT, and then you are applying the tax on that to get net income. As a part of the value of the firm, what we typically look at the after tax cash flows. So which is nothing but generally we take it after tax cash flows will come out as EBIT into 1 minus T, and when the taxes are not there, the EBIT is coming out to be the same, and the depreciation, whatever I am adding, is the same across. So if at all the taxes are not there, EBIT into 1 minus T plus D, whichever is resulting in the post-tax cash flows, that will remain the same, whatever is my capital raising mechanism. So that's where the theory says, when taxes are not there, the capital structure is really irrelevant, which means the value of a levered firm, means the value of a firm which has taken a leverage versus the value of a firm which has not gone for a leverage, value of a firm which has borrowed versus all equity finance, there is no difference at all. That's one of the most important propositions that they have come out with. But of course, this is far away from reality, because we cannot assume a scenario where the taxes do not exist. But if the taxes are existing, right, if the taxes are existing, what I could easily see is the interest is tax deductible, right? Because when we compute the tax, what after I get EBIT, we subtract I, get EBT, and on the top of that tax is applied. So if the taxes are there, if this I is higher, obviously EBT will be lower and the tax will be on this lower profit before tax. So the higher the interest, means higher the proportion of debt. So proportion of debt, if it is larger, obviously it can result in a lowest EBT, which means lowest taxes, which means the tax advantage or tax shield benefit that the company is getting is much higher. So if at all there are taxes, the same theory says, if at all there are taxes, it's better to go for 100% debt, because that is the optimal capital structure. So as per their proposition number one, two conclusions: if there are no taxes, capital structure is irrelevant, that is one. Whereas if there are taxes, 100% debt is the most optimal one. These are the two major conclusions that I can get out from the Modigliani and Miller proposition number one. When I look at number two, what they say is, as the leverage is increasing, the cost of equity will keep increasing, but the cost of capital actually is constant. This is their proposition, right? As the debt to equity ratio is increasing, what they are saying is the cost of equity will go up, but the cost of capital will remain the same. So cost of capital, because it is remaining the same, the capital structure again is really irrelevant if the taxes are not there. The way they have come out with the formula is, okay, we know, right, the formula is weightage of debt into cost of debt plus weightage of equity into cost of equity is nothing but cost of capital. So just to derive it, they said weightage of debt is debt by debt plus equity into cost of debt plus equity by debt plus equity into cost of equity is equal to the cost of capital. So I'll call cost of capital as some KO. So just a mathematics will give me D times KD plus E times KE is equal to KO times D plus E. So I can expand and finally say KE or E times KE, I'll go step by step. E times KE is nothing but KOD plus KOE minus DKD, and from here I can find out KE is nothing but D by E times KO plus KO minus D by E times KD. The other way of writing it is cost of equity is nothing but KO, which is cost of capital, plus D by E times KO minus KD. So this is like a linear equation, right? So the KE is coming out as KO, which is cost of capital, plus D by E times KO minus KD. I always see KO minus KD is positive, and D by E also will be positive only. So obviously this portion is always positive, which means cost of equity will keep increasing as the D by E is increasing. So basically it comes out to be a graph something like this. When I take D by E on the x-axis and cost of equity here, it keeps increasing as the proportion of debt to equity is increasing, especially when there are no taxes. Now if I bring in the taxes, all that I have to do in this entire exercise is, wherever the D by D is there, I'll take D into 1 minus T. So finally it comes out to such an extent that KE equal to KO plus D by E into KO minus KD into 1 minus T. That is what will come out on the simplification. This entire equation, only this part I will multiply with the post tax, which means the higher the volume of debt I have, probably I am getting more and more cost of equity, and 100% WAC will come down. I mean the WAC will be the minimum most, the cost of capital will be minimum most if the debt is 100%. So even this theory is simply talking about the capital structure is very very optimum at 100% debt. But on the other side, what you have to see is, as the WAC is increasing, sometimes for a regular scenario we say WAC is constant, and as the debt to equity ratio is increasing, the cost of equity will increase. That's a regular scenario. But some cases what could happen is, if the debt to equity ratio crosses the optimal range, means up to a large extent, as the debt to equity ratio is increasing, the cost of equity will increase, but overall cost of capital will remain constant. But what we are also saying on the other side is, if the debt to equity ratio crosses a certain optimal range, it so happens that the cost of equity will keep mounting drastically, which could very well result in the cost of capital also increasing. So that is where we have to really be worried of, because so many other things can come into picture. There is a possibility of bankruptcy costs going up, means the company's chances of being bankrupt are typically going up, or company's inability to pay on the loans can keep increasing, and that is what could contribute to even more higher cost of capital, because the risk of borrowing is possible to increase because of huge debt compared to the proportion of equity, especially when the earnings are going down. In a year when company's earnings or profits are down, it may not be able to fund its fixed cost interest with this EBIT, which may result in filing for bankruptcy. Just let's look at a couple of numericals. WACC is 12%, okay, cost of capital is 12%, cost of debt is 8%. Find the cost of equity. If the capital structure contains 40% debt, means equity is 60%. So debt by equity is 40 by 60. Okay, marginal tax rate is 35%. Now I can use that Modigliani Miller's proposition with tax, wherein I can say the cost of equity is equal to cost of capital plus D by E times KO minus KD into 1 minus T. So whatever I simplify, 12% plus, okay, 2 into 4%, 8%, 8% into 0.65. five point two by three 8% into 0.65 coming up to 0.5.2 by 3. So almost 1.7, probably 13.7 or 13.8% will work out as the cost of equity in this case. So this kind of simplifications can really help us understand what could be the cost of equity in case we get the other details. Similarly, if the EBIT of a company is 6 million, debt to equity is 0.6, debt is 25. If debt is 25 and debt to equity is 0.6, so 25 by equity equal to 0.6, so equity will become 25 by 0.6, probably which is around 41 point some kind of a million. So debt plus equity will become, which is the total capital, will become 25 plus 41, almost 66 million. That is the debt to equity. And if I want to find out the WACC, WACC is nothing but EBIT into 1 minus T by the total debt to equity. So EBIT, we already got it as 6 million into 1 minus T, 70% of it, which is 4.2 million, 4.2 million divided by 66. So these are basic simplification kind of scenarios wherein you should be able to understand the relationship between cost of debt, cost of equity, volume of debt, weightage of equity, and all these numbers, and even the EBIT, the role of EBIT in terms of deciding your cost of equity as well as cost of capitals. Then, as the leverage is increasing, so there is a lot of debt being used. If the leverage is increased, the usage of debt is increased, equity is decreased. So if the equity is very little used, there is no agency cost. What is the agency cost? That kind of a cost that the company has to bear because of conflict of interest existing between the owners and the management. See, owners are the equity investors. Management may or may not have shares because they are the employees of the company. But there are certain things that we have to understand in this context. Employees have a lot of information about the company because they are the ones who deal with the day in, day out operations of the company. Employees or the management of the company have more information compared to the investors, because the equity investors, they might have just invested, but they are not involved in day-to-day operations of the company. So if the leverage is more, probably debt is more, equity is less, which means the impact of the equity investors on the day-to-day operations of the company is much lesser. So the possibility of the conflict of interest also comes much lesser. But if the equity proportion is very high, I definitely see that the agency cost will be much higher because of conflict of interest between the management and the owner. It could be associated with any of the scenarios on how the residual losses have to be borne. It is associated with the monitoring cost, day-to-day operations. So the agency cost can come from multiple dimensions. It could be in the form of monitoring costs or bonding costs or the residual losses. Bonding costs are more to do with employee retention and all. So some kind of salary hikes and all to retain employees, the management can declare more of a salary hike, whereas the owners may not be interested for that because it is coming out from their capital. So the benefits which they would be receiving will go down if the employees start getting more and more benefits. So all these things, the recruitment costs, all these things create a kind of gap between the employees and the owners. And as it is understood that if the leverage is lesser, if more of equity is the investment, we see that this agency cost will be drastically going up. And wherever the agency costs are high, means the equity capital is more, the asymmetric information, asymmetric information, which is the management have more information compared to the owners, which will result in decisions being taken more from a management perspective. And because of that, what the management can typically think of doing is they give more preference to internal capital. So means more of a retained earnings will come into picture for funding the future projects. And if at all the retained earnings are not sufficient, then they prefer external debt, and finally they go for an external equity. This is what is being called as a pecking order theory, because managers, they always want, they don't want to incur additional burden in terms of external debt or something. They find internal capital to be used more and more extensively, because anyhow more and more internal capital being reused, it may result in flotation costs and all going down, which can work for the profitability of the company. Whereas on the other side, there is one more theory that I am looking at. It's not 100% debt which is the optimal capital structure, because the more and more debt is increasing, it could create the possibility of financial distress or bankruptcy, right? So the cost associated with the bankruptcy could be much, much higher. But at the same time, the more and more debt you are using, you will get tax shield benefit. So there is a cost with the increase of debt. There is a cost that it will increase your bankruptcy costs, as well as there is a benefit which is the tax shield benefit. So what we are saying is, as the debt is increasing, there is a benefit that is increasing, as well as there is a cost that is increasing. So every company has to choose that particular capital structure where the benefit that it is getting is more than the cost of financial distress. This can be different for different kinds of companies, but the optimal capital structure comes where the cost of financial distress, this will come out as the optimal mix, because this is where after this the cost of financial distress is going up compared to the benefit that is coming because of the taxes. So this is where the companies have to really look at going for. So this is the, if I assume that this is the tax benefit, and if I am assuming that this is the cost of distress, initially the cost of distress could be much lower, but as the debt to equity is increasing, the cost of distress could increase. So at some point you will find that the cost of distress is more than the tax shield benefit that the company is getting, and that is the point where the companies have to decide that this is the optimal capital structure for their operations. Alright, this is what we call as the static trade-off theory. And from a company's standpoint, they always decide their target capital structure basically based on the market value of debt. Right, here market value is very important. Market value of debt and market value of equity, they decide their optimal capital structure, or they decide their target capital structure. What should be the capital structure for the company in over a longer period of time? So probably let's assume that the company has decided that they will go for 40% debt and 60% equity. Now, in actual, at this moment also, if I see, probably they may be having 42 and 58, or they may be having 35 or 65, whatever it is. So their actuals at any point in time may or may not be the same as the target. There are various reasons that are associated with it. See, sometimes probably if the debt is available for a much cheaper rate for a shorter period, let's say if the debt is available, if the interest rates have gone down drastically and debt is available at a much cheaper rate, company wants to take an advantage of that particular opportunity. So these are all tactical decisions. In the very short term, they want to utilize some opportunity that has come up. So because of that, they have raised more loan than their typical targeted capital structure because it is available at a cheaper rate. So there could be various other reasons. So basically, when the market wants to exploit the short term fluctuations, or even if the equity market has fluctuated quite drastically, either the market value of equity has gone up or gone down drastically, the company cannot get ahead into the altering the values of the debt by paying off or taking an additional loan for a short period. You will find that the debt equity proportions could be much different from the targeted numbers. Or sometimes, if the company is not able to maintain the capital structure for any other reason, market conditions, it does not want to typically tamper with its proportions on a day in day out basis, so it will still allow for the actual capital structure to be slightly different from the targeted capital structure. And what we also see is, deciding between long term versus short term is heavily proportional with respect to inflation. If the inflation is very high, companies prefer more of short term debt. If the inflation levels are much lower, they don't mind going for long term debt also. Okay, let's take up one more numerical. If the market value of debt is 10 million, market value of equity is 30 million. So the debt to equity ratio or the capital structure here is based on debt to equity, both from a market value standpoint. So 1/3 happens to be the debt to equity ratio. Cost of capital is 11%, cost of debt is 7%, and tax rate is 30. You can find out the cost of equity. The same logic we have used earlier. Cost of capital, KO plus debt to equity ratio into KO minus KD into 1 minus T. This is what will work out as the cost of equity under this particular scenario. Then, on the other side, the capital structure plays an important role in the debt ratings also, because what we see is, if there is a large amount of debt compared to competitors or compared to the different firms in the similar industry or similar business risk taking companies, if the debt is more high, obviously the ratings will come down. And from a company standpoint, the ratings are coming down is an indication that the cost of capital is going to go up, which means the expected return on each of the projects is going up, and probably it will result in the value of the firm actually coming down. So the ratings, the debt ratings, are very closely related with the capital structure. So every company's management have a target with respect to the debt rating which they have to abide to. So because the cost of capital is very much tied with the debt rating, higher the rating, the cost of capital is lower, and vice versa. So from that standpoint, companies have to be more vigilant on this structure. Then, what all should a financial analyst look at if at all he is deciding one number for cost of capital for valuing the company? So how is the capital structure of the company changing over time? Is the debt equity ratio more or less constant for last few years, or is it more fluctuating? So if it is more or less constant, the analyst can very well use a similar kind of a number for the next few years also as a part of his valuation process for discounting the future cash flows. But if it is fluctuating more, an appropriate measure taking into consideration that particular risk also need to be looked at by the analyst. So one important thing that needs to be looked at is the capital structure constant across? Then what is the capital structure of the competitors which are operating in a similar kind of businesses? So for this company, if the capital structure is 30/70, whereas for most of the competitors it is 60/40, then it means that this company is operating at a different capital structure, whereas all the competitors are somewhere here. So probably you may very well assume that this company also very slowly may move towards this kind of a structure in a longer run. So you would prefer using this kind of a capital structure only for this company to do the valuation of the future cash flows of this particular company or project. So a comparison of the capital structures of the competitors is one more thing that needs to be looked at by the analyst. And apart from that, some company specific factors also need to be considered. The corporate governance of the company, how good is the quality associated with it, because the more is the quality associated, higher quality could result in lower risk, means could result even in a higher or lower debt to equity ratio. Leverage can very well be coming down, and even more of equity investment can be looked at in that particular company. Similarly, how transparent are the accounting practices? Because if the company is raising more and more capital in the form of debt, probably there is a possibility that the transparency is much, much lesser, whereas more and more capital in the form of equity, probably because of the various reporting scenarios, there should be more and more transparency. So any other costs which are specifically creating the risk to the particular company also need to be considered when evaluating the capital structure of different companies. And finally, whenever the analyst is focusing on comparing the capital structures of the companies in the international market, the focus should be on three dimensions: the institution specific and legal environment specific factors, look at the macroeconomic environment in both the countries, look at how the financial markets and the banking sector in those particular countries. Apart from the company specific capital structure, the focus should also be on the debt maturity structure. How liquid is the financial market and especially the banking sector? What are the macroeconomic factors, or what is the macroeconomic environment in that particular country? All these things need to be considered when we are comparing the capital structures of the firms in the international market, right? So this is what we need to understand as a part of the capital structure. I hope you got a very preliminary or very detailed understanding in terms of why should someone be really bothered about the capital structure, starting from Modigliani Miller propositions to the determination of the optimal capital structure for the company. And finally, also looking at what all should an analyst look at while evaluating the capital structure of a firm. If you have any further queries regarding the same, I request you to get back to me by giving me a call on this number, or you can even send in an email at vamsidhar@pacegurus.com. Thanks a lot for listening to this session. Thank you very much.